usually have people do is just to kind of give a verbal agreement that they, you know, are willing to participate in this project and are going to allow the museum to use it. So if you could just say your name and I agree.
Warren Widener, I agree to participate in the project and to allow the, your organization to use it.
Thank you. Okay, could you give the spelling of your name?
W-I-D-E-N-E-R.
And Warren is?
W-A-R-R-E-N.
Okay, and I wanted to get a little bit of background, your age and occupation and where you're from and how long you've been living in Oakland.
Let's see, I'm 56. Came to Oakland in 1956, actually to Berkeley to go to Cal. right now I am president of a foundation that raises money for urban revitalization organizations throughout California.
Mm-hmm. Where were you originally from? You said you moved to Oakland in 1956?
Yeah, I was born in Oroville and graduated from Oroville Union High School and went to Cal Berkeley.
Mm. Is that a place that?
It's about 160 miles north of here.
Okay. And where were you living at the time of the fire?
We lived on Ocean View, right near Manchester. We lived in a Spanish Mediterranean house that was designed by an architect named William Weeks. In fact, he built my neighbor, he designed my neighbor's house now, two houses over. and it was a street of old homes. Our home was built in 1927, and this house was built in 1927 also. Two doors down was a house that was designed by Julia Morgan called Redgate. And at the end of the block on the other street was another Julia Morgan house called the Honeymoon Cottage. And across the street and down, I think, three houses was a house that had been built by Bernard Maybeck as a one-room house, and then it had been added on.
Mm-hmm.
But, so this was a neighborhood of old, really quality homes that can really never be replaced.
Mm. And how long have you been living there?
We bought the house in 1985, so we've lived there about 6 years.
Mm-hmm. And what home was this in terms of, like, was this your third or second or another?
Let's see. Our first house was actually a triplex. We lived in in one side and rented the other two units out. We bought that in 1964 when I started law school. And then, can't remember when, sometime maybe probably 1967 or 8 or 9, we bought a house on Browning Street in Berkeley that was maybe half mile from our triplex. And then we lived there until we moved to Ocean View in 1985. So we lived in that house about 15 or 16 years before we sold it.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember when you first saw that house, why you decided to buy it, and, you know, what kind of meaning do you think that this house that just burnt down, it had for you and your wife?
Well, the first house we bought was a Spanish Mediterranean, and it had a nice floor plan, a great big yard, but we just outgrew it. One evening, my wife and I, we were sitting in our bedroom, and in our bedroom was a little desk, a TV, and we were saying, this is crazy. I mean, we pay the mortgage, and we're confined to one house, and the kids have everything. So we decided that we needed a bigger house. I remember my wife used to run around in the mornings. Everybody liked to take showers in the mornings, and so there was only so much hot water when you got five adults taking a shower in the morning. So she would time people and pound on the door, like, your time is up. So I said, that's no way to start off my day. So we're going to get a bigger house with a bigger hot, with several bathrooms that have hot water heaters in them. So we saw that house on a Sunday afternoon, and we had bought it the next Monday because I love the ceiling. I always like interesting ceilings in houses. And when I go to museums, like I go to the Louvre in Paris, I always look at the ceilings. And if I go into old castles in Europe, I look at the ceilings and how they were designed. So when I saw this ceiling, then I knew I wanted a house. And my wife went out in the back patio and had a redwood hot tub. And she always wanted a hot tub. Every time we remodeled, she would put a hot tub in the plans and I would strike it out because I knew that she wasn't going to maintain it. They take a lot of maintenance. Mm-hmm. And so so because it had the ceiling that I liked and the hot tub that she liked, we bought it. And sure enough, she never did maintain the hot tub.
Can you describe the ceiling?
It was beamed. When you looked up at the ceiling, you could see the beams. You could see the point of the ceiling, and inside it was as if they it had like a dark gray wood, and then you saw the cross members. It looked as if they had framed the ceiling with those trusses, and then instead of putting a flat ceiling over it, they just left it open so you could see it. But they were stained a gray color, and then they were stenciled. They had little stencil designs on them. And the so the room was like a story and a half high, and it was about 600 square feet. It had French doors that went out on the patio, and it had wall sconces around it, and a great big fireplace in one corner. So for me, it represented space and a place that I could just spread out and relax. And so every Sunday morning, I would put a fire in the fireplace and get my Sunday papers and sit down there and read the papers.
So you mentioned kids. Children. How many were you? Was it just your wife and yourself living in the house?
No, we had three sons. and when we moved to Ocean View, they were, I think they were all in high school then. And we believed in having them around the house. We'd rather have their friends over our house so we knew where they were.
Mm-hmm.
So that's another reason we wanted a big house. Mm-hmm. And so the school would, they would have parties in the house. There'd be 150 kids in the house at parties. And so they each had a big room and had plenty of space so they could feel comfortable in the house.
I was going to ask you how many rooms were in the house and just to try and get a picture of how big it was.
Let's see. Our oldest boy had kind of like a detached room that was about 400 square feet. It's about the size of like a double garage, and that was his bedroom and bathroom, and it was connected to the main house, but it was separate. So he felt that he was kind of separated out. And it had its own little hot water heater, and he had a you know, he and his mother actually, it had been a recreation room, and so they made it a bedroom for him. And so he had fancy tile shower, and you had to step up to get into the bathroom, and he had his own washer and dryer, stack washer and dryer in it. There he had gold faucets, and he had a brass toilet paper stand. I mean, they really...
They did it up.
I mean, I turned my back and they did it up. And then there was a little, that used to be a maid's quarters that was downstairs that we used as a guest room and sometimes as an office. And then it had a big den or study that I had my television in and an office. And then a breakfast room and dining room, a big living room, and a nice-sized kitchen downstairs. And upstairs, there were actually each of the twins had a bedroom upstairs, and they shared a bathroom. It was really an elegant bathroom. It was tiled from floor to ceiling, had an old antique toilet in it, and had an old wash basin, pedestal wash basin, and the water actually, most people couldn't tell where the water would come out of it, so it came out of, it looked like a little nose, and the water came out of there, so people would go up there and we'd have to say, well, just turn it on, well, where's the water going? Well, just turn it on, you'll see the water when it comes out. And their shower, it would have almost like a stage curtain on it. And then our bedroom was a really large bedroom, and it also had what had been a nursery, but it had been turned into a little sitting room into the bedroom. So everybody had a lot of space in the house and privacy, so that we all sort of spread out and felt that we had plenty of room.
I guess I'm going to then move to the day of the fire to find out, I don't know whether you were at home, but how the whole experience was for you and your family.
We went, we actually had Men's Day at our church, and I was the chairman of Men's Day, so we took off for our church at Downs, and we saw the fire truck going up the hill as we were on our way to church, but you know, you just said, well, I wonder where he's going. And after, during the church service, they announced that there was a fire and that people who were living in the open hills might want to go leave the service and go home and check on things. And of course, I never thought. I said, well, not us. So I really stayed in, went over to the social hall and to the receiving line, and then after we got in the car and started driving home. And when I got on Broadway in Ocean View and the road was blocked, then all of a sudden I realized that we were part of this fire. So we drove around and came up a back way and went through the house to see if the kids were there. And their cars were gone, and so we felt that they had probably left. I remember we told them that if there ever is a fire, get out, because the insurance will replace the goods. But I said, we have insurance on the furniture. We don't have insurance on you, so you leave. And so they did.
So they were actually here when the fire?
They were there, and a friend, I think they were both sleeping, because it was early Sunday morning. And so a friend looked up and saw the fire was up that way and actually got in her car and drove up and woke them up and got them out. We got there, it's about maybe 1:30, 1, maybe 12:30, sometime up around then. And the fire had not started burning around our area. It was catching, you know, little dry leaves and stuff on it. But there was no water pressure, so there was no water there. We saw a fire truck parked by a fire hydrant, but it wasn't doing anything. And so we decided that we should just leave because we didn't want to get trapped with those overhead wires. If something catches on fire or a transformer explodes, then you get cut off. You can't get downhill and trapped. So we agreed we would take one load of goods And then would each get in the car and drive down to the hotel and check in. And,
Oh, you seem so calm throughout the process. What did you take when you came?
Well, my wife got our big family portrait and some other pictures and, you know, a few clothes and the bills for a checkbook. And I got my campaign finance records because I figured that, you know, bad luck always strikes more than once, and I figured I would get audited if the records got burned up. And sure enough, I did get audited.
Oh my gosh.
And then I went in my closet and just grabbed an armful of stuff. And it was interesting because I remember thinking that we used to always see these homeless people with these big green garbage bags, you know. And of course, we had nice luggage, but you didn't think about, like, when you pack your suitcase if you go on a trip, like, you're trying to get out. So we grabbed these garbage bags and we threw them. So we threw it in the car and went down and checked into the hotel. And
so did you think you were going to come back to the house? I mean, what were you thinking at this time?
I thought that the house was going to be destroyed because
the
there was no water.
And
up there, and I just figured this fire, you know, once the fire jumped across the freeway, then that meant that that's a tough fire. When you go across an 8-lane freeway with a bark, and people talk about fire breaks now. Well, you've seen the Highway 24,
mm-hmm.
And that fire can come all the way across Highway 24, and if people don't have water, just give it up. It's
mm-hmm.
it's gone. And so when we left, we figured it was gone.
So how did you know that your sons were okay? Had they left a note or?
No, the cars were gone. And at that point, there was, you know, it was hot and the wind was blowing and you'd see like little sparks flying, but there was no fire.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it took a while before our house actually caught on fire.
Mm-hmm.
I think our house actually exploded from the inside, that you know, you have vents in the ceilings, and I think the fire actually got into the ceiling of the house and then burned. Of course, you have that just that plain wood in the ceiling and just burned the wood, and then when it gets hot enough, you know, the draperies and furniture in the house will catch on fire and then it will burn. But we had a tile roof and stucco house, so the fire, it wouldn't burn from the outside. It
mm-hmm.
just burned from the inside. We also had, we had just moved back into the house.
When it happened?
I was appointed to the Alameda County Board of Supervisors, and my district, my house was just outside the district, so we rented an apartment
mm-hmm.
for a couple of years. And then on October 5th, we started moving back into the house. So we got all of our belongings and possessions out of storage and put them in the house. We hadn't even had the pictures hang. They were along the wall where we were going to hang them.
Oh, wow.
And then there were cardboard boxes that hadn't been unpacked.
So you'd literally just been there for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So how long had you moved out for prior to that?
I think we'd been out from 78, maybe 79, I think. Maybe a couple of years.
I'm just amazed at how calm you are, because just in talking to a lot of people, they didn't immediately check into a hotel. They were roaming around and trying to find, you know, figure out where everybody else was, and then try and figure out whether their house is actually burned. But it seems like you were calm and...
Well, we knew. We went and got a hotel. We
mm-hmm.
checked into the hotel and got what belongings we had and put them in the room. And then we went back to the office and started calling around. And the kids would call us.
Mm-hmm.
And then when our alarm went off as the house began to burn, the alarm people would call those who were on emergency list. So they started calling us and saying that
mm-hmm.
there's a fire at your house. We said, yeah, we know.
Gosh, so what was it like, I mean, immediately after, I mean, how was it in terms of, I don't know if your sons took clothes with them or took belongings, but how was it trying to pick up your life? Because basically, I mean, even though you have some stuff with you, your whole life has just gone up in ashes to a certain degree.
Well, I think it hit most of the family harder than it did me, because that was also my district as an Alameda County supervisor. And I had gone through the earthquake in West Oakland, and now I had the fire. And so as soon as I got the family settled, and I had to go to the disaster headquarters of the county, and then I had to go back up into the area as a county supervisor.
How was that for you?
Well, it's kind of eerie, you know, because you don't expect to be both elected official and victim.
Simultaneously.
But in hindsight, my concern for helping my constituents and doing my job stopped me from focusing on the loss. And so I think all the other members of the family took it harder. But 2 years later, after I finished as a county supervisor, and then I began to focus on the job of getting our house rebuilt and getting it settled, that's when it really hit me hard. That you know, everything that I had worked for 30 years was burnt. Much of it could never be replaced. There was a Japanese, I've forgotten what kind of painting, but a painting that I had, that my friends had given me as a gift after I finished serving as mayor of the city of Berkeley. Mm-hmm. And I think they paid like maybe $900 or $1,000 for it. And the thing was probably worth about $20,000 now. There were just a lot of things that couldn't be replaced, and that had a lot of memories. And you know, our kids had graduated from high school there, and there were lots of family occasions. It was really hard trying to sort of deal with how you went from there, because you just kept focusing on how am I going to rebuild my house and my life. And it was only at a point where I decided that we wouldn't rebuild that house, that what I should do is forget about the past and just start building new memories, buy new paintings, getting new Father's Day cards, getting new furniture, and just move on. And so that's why we bought another old house. And like this is an old dining room table and set that we got at auction. So we go to auctions now and try to find old furniture and buy it. And at this point, you know, I feel that I recovered from the fire. It's history. Fortunately, we had insurance. The insurance paid us, and we bought another house, and we're buying furniture. And as you can see, I've gotten a few.
Accumulated some stuff.
Yeah. So it's history.
How did your wife take it in here, your son? You said they took it harder.
Yeah, they did. I remember that. She was pretty calm. You know, we were calm and methodical. But the second time the phone rang and somebody called, she answered the phone and they said, well, your house, you have an alarm at your house. And then she started crying. So then I wouldn't let her answer the phone. I answered the phone. But,
do you know some of the things that she lost that were really meaningful to her that was hard?
Well, There, you know, she saved most of the pictures, but a lot of them were lost. We started going together when we were in high school. So, you know how you have these high school yearbooks and you write in the yearbooks. So, you know, both of our yearbooks were lost. She recently discovered that she had her high school diploma that actually her mother had it. So she thought it got burned up, but when she was cleaning out, her mother was moving to a new apartment, and she was cleaning out her mother's apartment, so she found her high school diploma.
So she's happy.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. She had gotten a lot of nice things. She served on the board of the Federal Home Loan Bank of San Francisco, and they give you a nice silver tray with inscriptions on the year you were there. She had a nice clock. She served on the advisory board for Fannie Mae. Over a period of time, you collect things, and I think that those are the things that you miss the most, because there's no way, I mean, you can't replace them. You can't go back, and even if you said, okay, I want exactly the same tray, and I'm going to do exactly, it's just not the same. So I think that those are the things that were most difficult, because we did have a good insurance company and they paid us, and so we had money to replace the things, but it's just some of it you just can't replace.
Mm-hmm. What about your sons in terms of that?
I think that the young man that just came through here, mm-hmm. he's one of the twins, I think he had the hardest time, mm-hmm. because our oldest boy was in the process of moving to a new apartment. So he, you know, I think he was a senior at Cal. So he was pretty much, you know, he had detached himself from the house. And he had moved a lot of his stuff out. So he had the least impact on him. The other twin, I think he was staying going to Santa Cruz then. So he had a lot of his stuff at college, you know. And again, you know, once you move out of the house into a college dorm, you know, you begin to get a little bit detached. But the other twin, Michael, was staying there at the house, and he had accumulated a lot of computer stuff and had put into it a lot of creative work. He was going to be the next Bill Graham, so he did a lot of music, and also he had a lot of, he took a course at the Cal Extension on kind of the legal aspects of the music business, and so he had various kind of corporate documents and stuff, and so he had a lot of stuff that he had just dumped into this computer. And of course, when that goes, there's no way to retrieve it. I mean, it's just it truly is gone. And so I think that losing creative works is probably harder than anything else, because I don't think you can recreate something again. And even though it's music and it's documents, it's not like a painting or a piece of art. You know, for a young person, that's about all they've had time to create, mm-hmm. and so I think that's it. So I would say that the fire hit him harder than any of the rest mm-hmm. of us. And I remember you'd have to go back to the property with the insurance adjuster, and they would look and ask you questions and stuff. And so we went up there one day to meet the adjuster, and he got there before any of us. And I guess he went up and he went back, and we sat in his car and started crying. So it had a real tough impact on him.
Yeah, a lot of people, you know, talk about just the homelessness. You mentioned the trash bag, how you see people walking around. Just, you know, it's a reality that all of a sudden you have a structure there that you're living under, and you're familiar, you get mm-hmm. up in the middle of the night, you know where you're going. Mm-hmm. The next day, you're in a hotel room or whatever with no hope of ever being able to wear the favorite pair of jeans or whatever it is that, you know, and I'm wondering how it was, I guess I'm talking even more about minutiae, how it was to pick up the pieces in terms of like buying new clothes and how you progressed to the point where you're here now.
Well, the homelessness was, it was sort of painful and humorous. I remember, you know, when I woke up the next day and looked in that hotel room and realized that I was looking at everything I had after 30 years of working in this one hotel room. It's just, you know, it's almost as if someone has just stripped you of everything. You lost your college degree, you're standing there naked, no clothes, I mean, nothing. You're just sitting there saying, this is after 30 years of work, this is all I am right here. And even though you have insurance and so you know that you're going to get a house again, there is a feeling of homelessness. And we decided that we would not go out and buy a lot of stuff right away, because we said what you buy depends on, you know, where you are, and we don't want to be moving this stuff all around, and so we've got time. And some people in our church let us stay in their house for a while. It was a house that was being emptied because one of the male had recently passed, and so the widow didn't want to go back there right away, so we stayed there. And then we moved into an apartment in Emeryville, or actually two apartments in Emeryville, and then we had to move again. The thing I remember is how, as an elected official, you need to have cable television. I mean, you gotta have, and I needed CNN, and I needed, you know, the sports channel to just function. And between the fire and Christmas Eve, we moved four times. And so it seemed like every time I looked up, I was calling the cable TV people to put cable in. And different ones, you know, the people, like Oakland has one, Berkeley has another one.
And the stations are different.
Yeah, everything is different. And so it's just this constant moving. You know how you have to sit home and wait for them to come and turn on the gas and turn on the electricity? Well, most of the time you do that kind of like once or twice. Can you imagine doing that four times?
In a month,
you
know, and a half.
And finally, the last time we moved to our last temporary place was on Christmas Eve. So we spent that Christmas Eve moving. And I remember we moved and we said, look, we're just going to leave the Christmas tree here. And we'll just move into this new house without a Christmas tree. That we had, so one of our sons stayed with us in the apartment, and another one had another apartment in the same building. And then the third son, by then we had bought him a condominium, so he wasn't living with us. But so we were kind of all spread out, and then we had to rent office space. Usually you have an office in your house, but when you're in a little apartment, you don't. So we had to rent office space. And so just sort of keeping up with mail and people finding you. It's hard for people to find you, you know, because you just keep moving around.
Yeah. How is it in terms, you talk about your church, how is it in terms of community support? I don't know if it's different for you being a politician. A lot of people talk about friends and family members that they don't directly keep in touch with, or they were just amazed at how people, because, you know, everybody geared into action right after the fire, just in terms of the entire Oakland, Berkeley area to help everybody, the stores, everything. But how was it on a personal level?
We had a lot of support. And we had a lot of support. And I think that the thing that I'll always remember, that little check up there for $200 in that letter, there's this lady, Martha Booker, whose house was, you know, collapsed during the earthquake. And she didn't have any earthquake insurance. So She lived on Center Street in West Oakland. And so she couldn't get any help from anybody. And I remember seeing a picture of her just sitting there crying because she no longer had a house. So I decided we would rebuild her house. She reminded me of my grandmother. My grandmother used to live on Center Street, and we used to go there, and she had a big cookie jar, you know. And so we went, and actually, you know, over a period of several months, we had volunteers coming from like Santa Cruz, people who had been in the Santa Cruz earthquake. And we rebuilt her Victorian house as a group. And so when my house burned, she sent me this card with a check for $200, a money order with $200 in it. And so, you know, people did really come out and help. But the thing that was really painful was that, you know, for example, you would say, okay, I'm going to get up and I'm going to make some waffles. You know, I'm going to cook breakfast because I like to cook breakfast. So you get up and you know, in order to make waffles the way I make waffles, you take the eggs and you put the egg yolk into your batter, but then you take the whites and you put them in a little bowl, and then you get this little egg thing and you fluff it up so it makes the waffles lighter. And so you look around and you don't have your little fluff, right? So you stop, you get in your car, you go to the store, you go to two stores, you get a little fluff. By the time you come back, you say, to hell with the waffles, you know? And so it's almost every single thing that you do, you know, because you sit down, you make out a list, okay, now this is what we're gonna buy. But you can't possibly think of everything. And it's almost like every time you try to say, okay, let's calm down, let's get back to being normal. I'm going to do the things that I used to do and I really enjoy doing. And you start doing it, and then you get reminded of the fire because a little essential thing isn't there. And the thought of just getting in your, so you got to stop everything, go get in your car. A lot of people, I mean, you know, you tell jokes about women liking to spend money and shop. And men, you know, everybody likes to spend money in the shop. I'm going to tell you something. The house burns down, that's the last damn thing you want to do is go. I mean, I got so sick of going to the store and buying stuff that, you know, it's just, it's no fun because there's too much of it that you have to buy. And then you have to match, you know, like right now we're at a point where we sort of basically furnish the house. And so you can go and look at something and say, well, that'll fit. No, that won't fit. But when you first start and you have what you say, okay, you're going to buy a table and chairs. Well, that's going to set the pattern for everything else in the house. So
you have to think it out.
Yeah, it's all that pressure. You're saying, wait a minute. I don't want to sit at the card table. So we're beyond that. We have to make, but it's hard to make that decision because it's just, you don't have enough to go with. So those are the things I think that get people. And that's why we decided not to rebuild, because I think that except for those people that kind of could just say, okay, architect, take it over, call me when it's ready, you know. But for people who actually had to sit there and look and make decisions, it's not worth it.
Did you go back and see it, and how was it for you? I think you mentioned it a little bit earlier that your son had gotten there first. But
yeah.
How was it? I mean, it was burnt to the ground. What was there, and how was it for you? I mean,
I didn't get anything out of it. No mementos. I mean, everything was gone. And to some extent, there are things like, there are these great big books that are almost like the size of a newspaper open, and they're leather, and they have a lot of these clear little flip things in them. So in the 8 years that I was mayor of Berkeley, you know, we clipped all this stuff mm-hmm. and put it in there, and then I had all of these mm-hmm. notes, and I said, so, well, someday I'll, you know, I'll write a book or I'll go give it to the library. Mm-hmm. You know, you yeah. do something with it, because that was a pretty exciting time of my life. Well, they were all gone. There was nothing there to go back and get. So it's hard. It was really hard then. But, you know, now I kind of it doesn't. Yeah, I say, look, we were lucky. Nobody got hurt. I remember one. This is one of the things when. Oh, I don't know. I think when we first moved into the house in 1985 or 1986, after we'd been there a while, and I decided that I would get replacement value insurance, which is more expensive. But that means that instead of just paying you for what your house is worth, they will actually give you whatever money it takes to really replace your house. I remember when we were going over the budget, and everybody looked at that insurance and said, man, we ain't gonna be giving this insurance company all this money. We want to go to Tahoe, go skiing. And then, so everybody said, so we had a vote. The vote was 4 for Tahoe and 1 for insurance. And so they said, well, I said, wait. I said, I'm gonna tell you something. I said, now I'm the head of this house, so we are gonna pay the insurance. I mean, now you can go to Tahoe and go skiing, But you have to go skiing with whatever's left over after we pay this insurance. And after the fire, each member of the family kind of came up and said, you know, Dad,
we're
glad you were right. you were right. We're sure glad, man. He said, because, you know, boy, we couldn't have replaced this stuff if we had just had the regular amount of money. But now, you know, because some of the stuff that they had, they didn't make like computers. They didn't make them anymore. So they would then give them a computer that did what their old computer mm. did, it would do more. They couldn't give you one that did less, so they would give you one that did more. So they wound up with, you know, current up-to-date equipment. They, you know, because they had stuff that they would jack-lay, they'd get one thing and tie it all together, mm-hmm. and it was kind of three different mm-hmm. generations all kind of pieced mm-hmm. together. Well, now they got one nice computer.
Yeah,
so that was something that was really, really funny. So now, you know, I don't get too much static. People say, well, I think we ought to be conservative, we ought to do this. They say, okay.
well, I also wanted to, you know, you said that you didn't want to rebuild. Was this a whole family decision that you decided?
Oh, yeah.
And what,
yeah.
you know, what were some of the main reasons why you decided to do not? Because I know, when I've seen a lot of people who talk about rebuilding or who have actually moved back into their homes, mm-hmm. just even driving up there, it's so desolate that I wonder, mm-hmm. you know, it must be difficult to go back and your neighborhood is not even the same.
Well, for me, we really liked the house. And when we started working with the architect and the contractor, we were saying, look, just do what William Weeks did in 1927. And the architect said, well, no, you don't really want that. You want to update. You want this. I said, no, I don't want this. I want that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm paying for it, and it's my money. And the contractor, they would say, well, you know, you cannot, no one does this anymore. So here you need this other thing, and it's better, it's newer. I say, I don't want newer, I don't want better, I want the same. So we fought, and after I couldn't find another ceiling like I wanted, they designed this thing. I said, you know, I'm going to spend all this money, and these people are going to mess up my ceiling, and then I'm going to have to sit here, fight them, you know. And I said, I think it's healthier for me if I just give up on that house. Just say, that house is history. Take the money, you know, take some of my furniture. I'm not going to buy any skis. I'm not going to buy another bowling ball and bowling shoes. I'm not, a whole lot of stuff I just wasn't going to buy. And put it into another house that I like. And so I came home, we said that to my wife, and she said, well, okay. And so we came out, and this was the first house we looked at.
And you liked it?
Yeah. I thought we were going to have a big fight. My older son and I were the ones who were really working. We were the ones who were fighting with this architect and the contract and all these people. And so I said, well, I'm going to jump on it, man, and then I'm going to call you over later. So you stay, don't you go, you stay at home. So she said, okay. So I said, okay. So I called and said, well, you don't have to come over. I said, she just said, okay, because she's tired. She just came in from a plane trip, so she's going to give us a lot of trouble tomorrow. So you do this, we scheme. So we came in here, we came in this house and said, now we're going to give, we have 40 houses. And we said, okay, you look at this house. And she said, I like this one, I'll take this. And no, you got to be sure now. So we took her over to another. I said, well, I don't even want to go. I like the other one, and that's it. So we went back and said, now she's planning something. I know she's going to try to, she's trying to do something, but we are not building this house. So we finally just said, I'm going to tell you something. Now, you can, here's 40 houses. You can look at one and pick one out, but I'll tell you something. We are not building that house. We are lips. Now, you understand that? She said, okay, fine, I'll take this house. And so we got the house. And, I remember a couple people would say, well, man, that was an easy decision for her to make. This is a damn nice house. So she did. That wasn't a hard decision for her to make. So, but I think as soon as I made that decision, I felt better. You know, it was healthier for me to give up, mm-hmm. the history of the old house. And this house has the same floor plan, by the way, as the old house. And people, it's interesting because people who like our kids' friends, one of them came in and he closed the door. And he just stopped. And he said, unbelievable. You know, because it has the same floor plan. And he was used to, and then I remember someone came in and said, they looked around and said, gee, this is like your old house. I thought you got to take some money and get a different one. I mean, this is, it's bigger, but.